you hop inside my car. I got pictures, got candy, I'm a lovable man. I'd like to take you to the nearest...
Hello, Shamrock Nation. Dave Sal here, coming to you again from the SJO, the Shamrock Jazz Orchestra, with yet another outstanding all-star player interview for your enjoyment. Before we get into that, I want to remind you about our huge concert at the Magic Bag, scheduled for Sunday, July 24th, 2022. It's going to be the alumni event and the musical event of the summer. You don't want to miss it. Part of that group is with me today. He's sitting in the trumpet section, longtime veteran, trumpet player, and all-star in the jazz orchestra, Tom Dembeck. Tom, how are you doing today?
I'm doing fine today, Dave. How about you?
Doing good, doing good. We're recording this interview on Memorial Day, and yesterday was a big day for us, Tom. I know you know by now, but I want to make sure I tell all of our viewers, I'm not going to say fans because I don't want to be that assuming, but our viewers, that we've sold out our concert. Can you believe that?
Cool. I'm very surprised, but I'm happy to see that and happy to hear it.
Yeah, it's just an incredible thrill, you know, for us in the group, and just to see how this effort, which started with, you know, just my simple thoughts of getting some guys together and playing again. And I live in California, and most of you guys are in Michigan, and Tom Cusack is in North Carolina, and on, and how we pulled all this together, it's amazing. That not only did we pull it together and we've got a real thing going here, but now to learn that we sold 350 tickets to our event, our concert, it's going to be a packed house.
Well, that's probably El Marco's fault.
Yeah, I would agree. I would agree with that. So, all right. Well, so we've been through a few rehearsals by now, right? And I'm happy to say that we're making great progress. And I know we're going to put on a terrific show. But let's learn a little bit about you today. So you're obviously a trumpet player. I've said that a few times. What years did you go to high school?
I went to East Detroit from 74 to 76. So I graduated in 76. So I'm one of the older guys in the band now.
Yeah, you are, as a matter of fact. No, I'm teasing. That's great. So you went to high school 74 through 76. What bands were you in at the high school? Well,
I was in all the bands. I was in jazz band all 3 years, marching band all 3 years, concert band only in the senior year because I took up a second instrument, tenor saxophone. And pep band all 3 years. Did I catch them all? I think so. Symphonic band all 3 years. So that's what, five bands.
Wow. What a musical commitment that was. And then not only that, but just think about what that meant for Al Marco too, with all he had on his plate. And for those of you who don't know, Al Marco was our band director and a guy that all of us respect greatly. And we, by the way, we will have a nice short, brief honoring ceremony at our concert for Al and his memory. He passed away last year. But think about what he had on his plate and the commitment and running all those bands and all the students. I can't believe he did what he did.
Well, as we mentioned in an offline conversation once before, I don't know how the man did it because he was always at school. You got there first hour and Chief was there. And when we left at the end of the day, he was there. Come back for marching band, he's still there. And then after marching band, I think he went back and slept in the band room actually a lot of times because he always seemed to be there. I don't know how he balanced his home life with his work life because the man was definitely committed to what was going on in school all the time.
No question. And you know, I'm sure you remember, because I was obviously in bands also, that we also had sectional rehearsals in the evening. There was no time during the day because we had our other classes. So any specific sectional rehearsals or practices we did, or challenges, if you remember challenges, you know, you got challenged for your chair in the particular section that you sat in. He did all of that after hours. So I just can't believe what the guy did. And you know, we're all the better for it. So, okay, you graduated in 76. I know that you also went to high school or East Detroit with George Beyer, who's our MC for the concert this summer.
Well, yes, I did. And it was a funny story how George and I really got to meet. Yes, he was in high school when I got there in band, but I didn't really know him well yet. And we were at Memorial Field at a big party that was out there. And I remember sitting on a blanket with some friends, and George came walking by. And at one point he says, "Is anybody looking for a job?" And of course I said, "Yeah, I need a job. What is it?" He goes, "Well, I work at a gas station. We need somebody to work there." And I said, "Sounds great to me." So I went in and started working with George like the following Sunday, I believe it was, or Saturday. And at the end of the day, George and I forget the other guy's name that was working with us, but George and the other guy were in the back straightening them up and putting things away. And I was sitting in the front office. This is Outer Drive and Van Dyke, right on the corner. And in walks a gunman with a stocking over his head, puts it in my face and says, and of course I went, "Oh, what?" You know, I'm a 16-year-old kid, first day at work down there. He goes, "Don't put your hands down or get in the back." So we get in the back, and to make a long story short, we all walked out of it alive. You know, he didn't shoot anybody, but that was my first day at work with George, and I ended up working there 4 years, actually. And part of that, during the course of that four-year period, George started calling into the radio station, and he'd ask me and the owner to go in the office while he called from the back of the station. And we watched him in the back of the station while listening on the radio for the show, and he'd be doing his impressions, the Popeye and the rest of them. And we saw him get his start on radio, literally from the back of that station. And then one day he got a call and they said, "Come on down," and that launched his career.
Wow. Wow. So first of all, you went to high school with George. Was he always a clown? Was he clowning around during
high school? Yeah. And he sat right behind the trumpets, and trumpets are known to be kind of clownish themselves. And it's just the nature of the beast, I guess. But George sat like over my shoulder in the baritone section, euphonium section for, I think he was class of 74. So he graduated. We had 1 year together where we were overlapped in symphonic band.
And so you start a job with him, and your first day on the job, you get robbed.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, unbelievable. You can't make that stuff up, that's for sure. Well, he's a great guy and talented, and obviously we know how he went on with his career locally in the Detroit radio market. So we're honored and excited to have him be a part of our concert. It's gonna be a lot of great entertainment for the concert goers that come and see us. All right, well, you certainly ran the gamut at East Detroit in terms of all the musical education available. What was your favorite memory of jazz band specifically?
Oh, there were so many. One of the ones that I really remember clear as a day is when we got to open for the opening show for the McDonald's on 9 Mile Road. They asked Marco to bring, if the jazz band could come down and play for the opening, which we did, their grand opening. And at that grand opening, there were a couple of executives from McDonald's corporate. And at one point after hearing us, they came up to the chief and they said, I keep saying the chief, that's Al Marco. It was one of the names we, as Dave knows, but a lot of folks out there may not. We call him chief a lot, so I slip sometimes. They had talked to the chief and said, "You guys want to borrow our bus?" And we're like, "Well, for what?" And we looked and we then go, "Come on over and look." And we look in and there's a giant Greyhound bus that had been converted into this luxury bus to take the executives all over the country for these openings. So we were honored and flabbergasted to be able to have that for our trip to Central Michigan University for one of the competitions up there.
And I understand you won that competition.
Yeah, we took best band that day at the first annual All-Star Jazz Festival at Central Michigan University, yes. I think that was 1976.
And that's phenomenal, but common under Al Marco's direction, because I know when I was in high school there, 76 through 79, we won almost everything we entered. If we did, I don't remember specifically, but I know we were on a roll. And between the symphony band and jazz band and concert bands that I was in, we always were winning because he knew how to get the most out of us as kids. Mm-hmm. who were just learning to play instruments. So it's phenomenal. Okay, so after high school, you went to college. Looks like you went to Macomb. You played in jazz lab band there. So tell us quickly about your musical career after high school.
I, along with what I've seen from a lot of the bandmates that are doing this, took a bit of a leave, not really playing. I wasn't playing with any bands for a number of years, probably about 15 years, 20 years maybe, where I had my horn sitting on the stand and I'd pull it out and play once in a while, but there was no commitment, nothing regular, until 2000 when I joined the Warren Concert Band and I started playing trumpet with them. So that was in 2000. This marks the 22nd year with them, actually, which, by the way, is our 50th anniversary for that group. But, there was a long time of not playing with any groups before I joined up with them.
Got it. Yeah, I'm looking at some pictures here now. There's one of the Warren Concert Band trumpet section. There's like six or seven of you in there. And then there's a individual shot of you. And then a group picture, Dan Hagen, Bob Lepley, and Tom Dembeck. Tell the group who those guys are.
Well, Dan Hagen was our drum major in high school for, I believe, 2 years, 75 and 76, I think. And Bob Lepley was our junior high band director, who, by the way, both of those guys, that was at a Warren Concert Band event. And they both play in the Warren Concert Band with us now. And it's really joyful to have some old alumni in that band and being able to play with our old band director from junior high school. Bob Lepley was a terrific director as well as Al Marco.
You know, I'm going to stop it for 1 second. That is what this is all about, too. We're actually, although Bob Lepley wasn't my junior high school band director, I had Mike Skrinsky at Oakwood. Bob Lepley was the band director at Kelly. And you and Chris Michaels and Molaski and Cusack. And, you know, I think more than half the band went to Kelly Junior High and we're actually having fun. And Bob Lepley's going to guest conduct us at the concert on a number or two. I mean, what a thrill it was for him. He's already been to one or more of the rehearsals. He got all choked up about it. And the nostalgia involved in this is just terrific. So, you know, forget the sold out, forget the big show and forget all that stuff. There's where the value is, right?
Oh, it's an absolute joy being able to have your junior high band director. You know, I was 14 years old when he was directing me. I'm a little older than that now, but I won't say how old, but a little older than that. And I have the honor of playing with my junior high band director. I mean, it's phenomenal. It's just a wonderful experience. It really is.
Yeah. Yeah, it sure is. And then to reconnect with your classmates and like you and I, we didn't know each other before this effort, right? But because we're kind of connected through the jazz band legacy or the jazz band program over time, you know, we have the opportunity to, you know, do something really cool here. So it sure is fun. Okay, so you got married, you got a personal life, I assume. Tell us about that.
Well, I married my wife, Cindy Grifka, who you know. You went to school with her back in the day, I believe, at St. Leonard's. Got married in 1985, so it's like 36, 37 years this year. We've got three kids, twin girls and a son. And our son just got married last year in March, and this past January gave us our first grandchild. So we're really excited to have a grandchild around finally.
Yeah, I'm looking at a picture here of Cindy and you. By the way, tell Cindy I say hello, and I can't wait to see her at the show because it's been a real long time. But I do remember her and her brothers and sisters from St. Leonard. But here's a picture of you and Cindy with your first grandchild, Colton.
Yep, Colton James.
That's great. That's great. And then the family Christmas picture, all of you are standing outside looking like you're freezing your tails off.
Yeah, that's a tradition that I started a number of years ago. Is I started forcing them to go to cut down the Christmas tree. And we've been doing it about 6-7 years. Well, we've been doing it with our kids since they were babies. But now that they've got significant others and spouses, you know, they still come out and we still do it every year, take the family photo. And it's become an event in the family and a real great tradition that everybody looks forward to every year.
So you get everybody in the family truckster and go on the good old family, old-fashioned Christmas vacation trip to go find the Christmas tree like Chevy Chase did in Christmas Vacation.
Oh, yeah. And the kids still act like they're 10 and 12, even though they're much, much older than that now. It's a lot of fun. It really is.
That's awesome. That's awesome. All right. Tell us about your work career.
As you know, I started off in right out of high school. I started off in banking after the gas station gig with George. I finally moved on to banking, did that for a number of years. And it was a former bandmate that got me into that from East Detroit, another trumpet player. And then later on, I moved on to drafting, you know, to change careers. And then eventually moved into information technology. I finally got around to finishing my degree back in 1993 at Walsh College. And then I transitioned into information technology and been doing that pretty much ever since. Now just looking forward to that retirement at the end, you know.
Well, Tom, you and I, we both have our eyes set on retirement. I don't know about you. I don't think I'll ever really retire. Always need to be doing something.
Well, yeah, there's going to be more bands, you know, and who knows what might happen with the SJO, you know.
Maybe a world tour. Maybe a world tour. Where if we were to play a world tour, we'd play big venues. And we've saved the best for last in your interview because you were part of a group with me and a few other choice members of the SJO. We got to play the gig of our lives. Why don't you tell everybody about our opening for the Jay Giles Band?
We sure did, Dave. And that was a fluke. They put out the call for a marching band, couldn't get one because, you know, band directors were a little bit leery about having a bunch of their high school kids go play with some big name group with drug scene and all that rock and roll stuff. So somebody, I know there's been some going back and forth about who actually put it together, but somebody was able to call into the station and say, hey, I've got a marching band. And then in short order, we made some phone calls and got about, I think 20 of us, there were 20 to 25 of us. We went off to El Marco and we had asked him if we could borrow some band uniforms because we're going to play the Jay Giles show at Cobo. And he said, well, I don't think I could loan those to you. We said, well, how about if we sweeten the band fund with $100 or so? And he goes, then it's not, then you're making a donation. And yes, it could be considered maybe a rental. So we did that. We borrowed some hats, some coats, and we got out there and we marched around with the Jay Giles band on the opener at Cobo. We got to meet Peter Wolf and Magic Dick and the rest of the band backstage. And after the first night, we were invited back to do two more shows. The Cobo was sold out. That was November of 78 for three nights. It was a wonderful experience. We got to march with them on stage, sit on stage for the whole show, and it was a fabulous experience.
It really was. I got a picture, and you actually sent me this picture because before I met you, I didn't have one single picture of this event, not one audio clip, nothing. All I had was a memory, and I would tell certain people about it, and they go, oh, yeah, right. Are you kidding me? You're making that up. And I didn't have anything to prove it, you know, and now at least I got some, you know, witnesses to
attend. With the marching band hats.
with the garb on for sure. And a great picture of us on stage. You know, I can't really identify myself in this mix because unfortunately the picture is from behind, but you know, anyway, what a thrill it was. I'll never forget that. And I remember our dressing room was a cinder block wall with no heat, folding chairs, and it was freezing cold down there on the Detroit River in the wintertime. Yep. But I do remember Peter Wolf laughing his tail off at us. And the other significant thing about this gig that we played was that we had a drum major. I won't name his name, but we had a drum major who was not really a drum major, but he was drum major of the night
for this show. Honorable.
Yeah, the honorable. And he started marching back. He was facing us as we were playing the fight song that we were playing, marching backwards. And he ran out of stage and fell right into the crowd. And remember back then that they did not have any barrier between the stage and people. So fortunately for him, there was, you know, a few hundred people right there in front that caught him. And they kind of, I do remember this. They passed him around a little bit. I was laughing so hard, I couldn't play. I just could not play. And they threw him kind of back up on stage, like kind of chucked him up on the stage. He'd lost his staff, you know, the wooden stick, if you will, and his hat, which was, you know, a marching band or a director's, it was sideways. And it was so hilarious. And I remember watching Peter Wolf just slap his knee, laughing. It was unbelievable. You can't make that up. Even that's a Ferris Bueller's Day Off kind of.
Yeah, and Alto Reed was there, too, and I'm sure he had a good laugh about the whole thing because we were backstage with him, too, and he was talking to him and laughing the whole time, so I'm sure that he got a kick out of that.
Unbelievable. I don't think he did it the second and the third night because he learned his lesson on the first one, but, I mean, what a lifetime memory. All right, Tom Dembeck, thanks for joining me today. It's been a great conversation, as they always are with you. I'm really happy that you're in the group. We're having a great time. Shamrock Nation, make sure you're there Sunday, July 24th at the Magic Bag to see the Shamrock Jazz Orchestra. Consider it an all-year East Detroit High School alumni reunion. We are sold out, but what I would encourage you to do, though, is if you're still looking for tickets, check the Facebook groups. Of course, we're big on Facebook by now. And just post to the other and various East Detroit High School Facebook groups. There are many of them. And there might be some tickets floating around there that you could grab if they're going unused. So we'll see everybody Sunday, July 24th. Tom, great to speak with you and have a great Memorial Day.
You too, Dave. I look forward to playing this gig with you. Gotta get back.